Welcome to the world of Swafinia. A few 5 million years have passed since the animals and plants were left to their luck by humanity. And during these 5 million years, the warming world of Swafinia has shaped itself, and it is pretty easy to see. In this episode, we'll be seeing the abiotic factors present at the current time in Swafinia history, and I'll be explaining each and every single one of them. Beginning with the climate itself now, the world is in a greenhouse period. A time of warm climates where rainfall is very common and the average temperature of the planet is almost completely tropical. The ice caps that once were present on this planet have melted away, leaving only the tips of the highest mountains as the only places where ice and snow form year-round. Most of the continents in Swafinia are quite flat in terms of terrain, and added to the increased rainfall and warm temperatures, most of the continents are covered in dense, expanding, swampy forests with a flooded forest floor. Just the perfect environment for plants and fungi to thrive, and along with them, animals. The sea level, although higher in this time, doesn't affect much of the land, but it does create spots of shallow seaway and banks, where seagrass and corals can take over. There are four continents in Swafinia, beginning from the northernmost one to the southernmost one. The northernmost continent is Swafinia, a huge landmass about the size of Africa. Swafinia is actually quite the outlier in Swafinia, having only some parts of its landmass reach the equator, and thus only having one moderately sized rainforest at its southern peninsula. There's a desert that divides this peninsula from the rest of Swafinia, and the rest of the continent has a more temperate climate, which gives way to large prairies, temperate rainforest, and some areas of Mediterranean climate. There's also other features that are part of Swafinia, such as Isla Bifurca and a peninsular savanna near its southeastern parts. The next continent is Ent, an island continent only slightly larger than Australia that's found almost entirely in the equatorial zone of Swafinia. This causes most of the continent to be covered in a large, dense rainforest larger than the Amazon, where most of Swafinia's biodiversity is found. The driest areas of Ent are usually monsoon-driven dry forests or small savannas, and the alpine regions of Ent are somewhat composed of cloud forests. The other island continent of Swafinia is the island continent of Shum, an island continent which is only slightly smaller than Australia. Compared to Ent, it has a drier climate, having a rainforest near its northeastern part, a large savanna near its center, and a large desert in the rest of the continent. And lastly, the largest continent of Swafinia is that of Mauritania, a continent so large that it spans throughout all the climate regions, from the southern pole to the equator of Swafinia. Mauritania, being almost a supercontinent on its own regard, has a variety of climates, from temperate grassland to tropical rainforests to dry deserts and dry forests, and having the only tundra found in Swafinia, with this tundra being found on the southern pole of Swafinia, where some of Mauritania's landmass lies. We now move to Swafinia's oceans. Most of Swafinia's oceans and seas are quite shallow and allow for a large diversity of animals in oceanic environments. The northern pole of Swafinia is completely covered in water, with this area of the ocean being called the Swafinian Sea, due to the coast of Swafinia taking up most of it. This cold sea is rich in phytoplankton, and many filter-feeding species migrate here to feed. There's also many other important seas outside the northern pole, such as the Fisher Pool Sea, a shallow sea that separates the continents of Shum and Mauritania. This sea is quite average among the major Swafinian bodies of water, with seagrass and coral being present in the northern parts of the Fisher Pool Sea, but with the southern part of it being covered in kelp forests. The Fisher Pool Sea is quite the average, but not to be underestimated, body of water. Another body of water found in the more equatorial waters of northern Mauritania is the Mirando Sea, a small oceanic area where some of Mauritania's peninsulas and some islands are found. The coasts and shallows of the sea are quite rocky, and are some of the few areas of Swafinia where stromatolites and other rocky structures form. This allows for this area to be dominated by large coral reefs, where a lot of oceanic biodiversity is centered, and aside from its biodiversity and unique environment, it is quite the average body of water. Another large body of water which is quite interesting is the Austral Sea. As its name implies, it's located in the southern hemisphere of Swafinia, near the landmass of Muratica. The characteristics of this sea makes it rich in phytoplankton and kelp forests, which allows multiple life forms to dwell here. Aside from that, it isn't a very remarkable body of water in Swafinia. And lastly, the last body of water to discuss, but one of the most important ones, is the Great Equatorial Sea, a large shallow expanse of ocean between Spofera Ends and Muratica. This sea is mostly equatorial and warm, allowing for seagrass and coral to dominate throughout, but this place is where most of the unique oceanic biodiversity is centered as well, and many species here have unique adaptations to live here. The continents and important bodies of water of Swafinia are all set, as they've been molded by the hotter and warmer climate, and soon we should start discussing animals and plants that thrive in these conditions. We'll be starting from the northern continent Swafera and moving our way down. The first episode should be the Swaferan Eastern Peninsula and its temperate rainforests. Until next time, goodbye.